Well, good afternoon, everyone. Are you awake? You know, after we have lunch, sometimes we have to just stretch a little bit. Maybe you should do that just now. Just put your hands up really high, and we're just going to praise God right now. There we go. Or Allah, or whoever it is that you worship. And we are here today because we have a treat for you, and we're so thankful to be a part of this. Hennepin Avenue United Methodist has been here for almost 150 years, and we are a church that really believes that we have to come together, all the faiths, our whole neighborhood, so that we can learn from one another and be the people that God calls us to be, to love our neighbors and do that deeply. Not just up on the surface. So we have done, we're thrilled to have this partnership with Hamline University and the Mahle Lectures. The Mahles are members here at Hennepin, and we're sad that they cannot be with us today in person, but I bet you they are watching. So lots of people are online with us today, so we're thankful for that technology that allows us to be together from far and wide. I want to introduce to you Tesfa. He's going to introduce himself, and you're going to get to know him. He was with us in worship this morning. And if you missed it, you can go online and watch that. He preached, and he did a wonderful job. So will you join your hands in welcoming Tesfa and the Hamline University Mahle Lectures to Hennepin.
Thank y'all so much for coming out again. Hopefully your souls are filled by the yummy soul food that you had at Soul Bowl. Or the wings that you had at Bad Wings. Grateful that, you know, Hamline and Hennepin made this possible. The story begins on January 3rd, 2006. The day my mom left this earth. We had a funeral on January 6th. And I sat in the pew. Something was pulling at me to go stand up and sing to her one more time. Never in a million years would I know that that song would be a prayer. A prayer I think about often. Is that as our journey ends, do we find Jesus? Do we find salvation? Do we find each other? How Mama raised me in that church, Greater Middle Baptist Church, that chubby kid sitting in the back row, sleeping on Mama most Sundays. The thing that always woke me up were these old Negro melodies. Somehow, I felt revived, awake, alive. When Benjamin Hooks and the deacon board and the mother board and the whole church started singing these
Negro melodies. As a part of this 60-day trip around the country, many of those melodies entered my heart, entered my mind, penetrated my soul. On day two, I arrived in Kenosha, Wisconsin. I parked my car right where Jacob Blake was shot 7 times in front of his kids. I cannot begin to imagine what those boys felt. Cannot begin to imagine all the troubles so many kids, like Jacob Blake's sons, have seen in a society where apathy has handcuffed us. Those troubles, the same troubles that my ancestors felt on the plantation years ago, those are the same troubles my people are feeling today.
Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Nobody knows but Jesus. Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Sometimes I'm up, sometimes I'm down. Oh, yes, Lord. Sometimes I'm almost to the ground. Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Nobody knows my sorrows. Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Glory, hallelujah.
Sometimes I'm up, sometimes I'm down. Oh, yes, Lord. Our story is not all sorrow. Our story is also joy. Blackness is unconquerable, unbreakable. Blackness is divine. But I still think so often as I walk down Pulaski Road in Chicago. It was so loud, 18-wheelers, horns, so noisy. This was the same road that Laquan McDonald took his final steps, where an officer shot him 16 times. And the song hit my heart as I walked. I want Jesus to walk with me. How many parents, uncles, cousins send their black babies out into impossible streets praying that Jesus will walk beside them? Day after day, knowing just how impossible it is to navigate these situations. And how many of us, including myself, have the privilege to walk around in comfort, to be able to drive a Prius, to park a Prius, and walk around on Pulaski Road, recognizing that that privilege has not been afforded to everybody.
I want Jesus to walk with me. I want Jesus to walk with me.
In my heart as I walked amongst my people, attempting to be in community with my people. And I eventually met up with a dear friend as we walked together in Louisville, Kentucky. Because just the day before I met this beautiful soul, I walked around Breonna Taylor's apartment. It was her birthday. There was a balloon outside and chalk painting in front of the door. As I walked around investigating, I began to feel the apathy of the officers investigating the incident. Because on the outside, you would think nothing happened. But if you looked in the window, you still saw broken glass. You saw broken fiberglass. You saw and felt apathy. Because as I kicked around those red rocks, I found this broken fiberglass. I found this broken glass. And I found this empty bullet casing they didn't even care enough to clean up. Doesn't matter if this was the bullet that was shot inside of her apartment. But the fact that I could just come and kick a rock as I walked in Louisville and find this represents the apathy that's killing us all. They shot inside of her apartment over 30 times. In my mind, they crucified her. We have to start naming it what it is. They crucified her. just like they've crucified so many of us. And at some point, it has to stop. At some point, the people in this room have to be willing to put their bodies on the line, to step up and not let any more crucifixions take place.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord?
Journey continued. My spirit started to rise, because after leaving Dr. Pollard in Louisville, after going to that incredible, incredible Breonna Taylor exhibit, we saw the truth there. We felt it. Got in my car and drove to Cincinnati, Ohio. And in Cincinnati, I went to the National Underground Railroad Museum and learned a lot about John Rankin and John Parker. John Parker was a free black man with two patents to his name, who had a house on the Ohio River, who risked everything day after day after day for strangers who stood on the Kentucky side. But just up the bluff, a white man named John Rankin was his co-conspirator. They worked together to free thousands of slaves, risking everything for a stranger. That is what we are called to do while we live, to risk it all for strangers, for our neighbors, for our kin. But I just imagine the spiritual deep river as I stood there looking across, imagining my ancestors, some of them probably walking hundreds of miles barefoot, the resilience, the toughness, the perseverance, the strength, the courage to get to that water. Walking by faith, knowing that there was the possibility of freedom on the other side. That water is deep, y'all. That water can cleanse us too. It's time for us all to take that bath. Cincinnati, I noticed the F. Biden flags, the Don't Tread on Me flags, the Confederate flags, and that was the same land where a white man and a black man worked together, risked it all for their unknown kin. That story lifted me. Sometimes I'm up. Because as I continued my trip in Ohio, I eventually got to a point as I'm heading to Detroit and Flint. I see the sign that says exit for Fremont, Ohio, to go to the Rutherford B. Hayes Presidential Library and Museum. You see, in the Compromise of 1877, Rutherford B. Hayes effectively ended Reconstruction, removing the Union soldiers from the South charged to protect our black bodies. Because the compromise was just a way for them to hold on to power. What we know is that as these deals are being made, the people who suffer are non-white. But it leads us to the potential, the scary potential, of the compromise of 2025. As we recognize and see all of these pieces aligning, time is drawing nigh. I parked my car outside of the museum. I was smiling so hard. I started singing verse 2 of the Black National Anthem. I channeled my inner Pavarotti. And I loved the curious look from my white neighbors. Staring, why is this brother so happy right now? Because I just smiled, even through our suffering. Our blackness, as I said, is unconquerable. We are unbreakable. We are divine.
Stony the road we trod, bitter the chastening rod, felt in the days when hope unborn had died, yet with a steady beat have not our will. A place for which our Father sighed. We have come over a way that with tears has been watered. We have come treading our path through the blood of the slain. Out from the gloomy past, till now we stand at bright gleam of our bright star is cast.
I got back in my car and continued my journey with stops in Flint, in Detroit, in Pittsburgh, in Philadelphia, in New York, and then eventually to Baltimore, where I parked outside of Corinne Gaines' apartment. Corinne Gaines was pulled over for not having appropriate tags on her car. She missed a mandatory court day. They served a warrant for her arrest. They came to her home. She wasn't having it that day. But we know how this story ends. It ends with her crucifixion. At the time when they entered the apartment, her son, Cody Gaines, was also inside. He was also shot in the incident. Now, that's a privilege check for me because I got pulled over in 2008 for not having appropriate tags on my car, which required a mandatory court day. And I had a privilege to go to my school that morning and tell my principal. And my principal went to the assistant principal and said, cover his classes for the day. Make sure that we get this taken care of. That is privilege. Some folks cannot even afford to take a single day off to deal with it. And I think about Cody often, how he and so many other kids don't have their parents anymore. They don't have that loved one, that auntie, the grandmama, providing love and comfort as we deal with trials and tribulations. These motherless children, it's not okay, y'all. It's not okay.
Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child.
Without her father. Every day I get in my car, every day there is the risk. And it's scary. But we can change it. We must find our empathy and remove our apathy. You see, later on in the trip, I got to Brunswick, Georgia, only because the Reverend Dr. Alton Pollard said to stop. I turned into the Satilla Shores neighborhood, and there was a white man there, dropping off his boat. And the only thing I felt from him was empathy. As he drove me over to where Mod's Run began. Because you see, this is the neighborhood where they hunted and killed Ahmaud Arbery. One of the last things he said is that even if he was stealing, he did not deserve to die. I got back in my car where his run began and FaceTimed with a friend, and I drove back into the Satilla Shores neighborhood. And I parked my car, and there was a white woman. And I said, my name's Tesfa, and I'm on a 60-day journey around the country trying to learn what do we need to repair our communities. And the first words out of her mouth is, why won't y'all just leave us alone? They keep telling the black people that they're being mistreated. Had they not filmed it, the law would have taken care of itself. In that 30-plus minute conversation, never once did she express empathy or remorse, even though Ahmaud Arbery's body fell just feet from where she stood. Now, I could have taken the time and energy to try to talk to her about it, but there was nothing I was going to say to her because she's been marked by the beast. There's so many people out there at this point who've been marked clearly. We see signs of it everywhere. I offer grace. I turn the other cheek and I said, thank you. God bless you. I got back in my car to go pick up my mentor in Jacksonville, Dr. Andre Thomas, one of the leading scholars on the Negro spiritual, these melodies. But before I got to him, I stopped by a friend's house, Dr. Cara Tasher. And she opened that door. And she looked me in the eyes. And I looked in her eyes. And we didn't say a word. She just opened her arms. And I fell into her arms. And I felt peace. I felt stillness. I felt empathy. I came into the peace of wild things. And in that peace, I knew it was possible for more people who looked like her to make that happen day after day. Every day you wake up, you have that opportunity to just open your arms and look out to your neighbor, to recognize that there are no strangers, there are no enemies, there's only kin. Of the
time I rest in the grace of the world, and am free.
Picked up my mentor, Dr. Andre Thomas. And we drove to Rosewood, Florida, where in 1923, they burned down an entire black community. But they didn't just burn it down. They made cruelty the point. Created the carnival. Thousands of people from all over drove to this small town near the Gulf of Mexico to celebrate in the pain that they caused a black body that looks like me. I just imagine as they tried to escape those atrocities, the swampy waters, right on the side, as they're heading towards Gainesville, hoping to escape death. They walk through those troubled waters. Risking everything, taking nothing with them. The only way out, because once the train left, you're either going by foot or through the waters. So many of them were able to make it, but some did not. And it's a story that not many of us talk about. So many of us didn't even know of Tulsa, 1921, until recently. But when 2023 comes, we might be talking about Rosewood, Florida, and the repentance that's needed to make it right. Because where I felt the heaviest, where I felt the most pain, was in Montgomery, Alabama. When I went to the EJI's Lynching Museum, also known as the Memorial for Peace and Justice, I walked inside and I saw statues of Africans chained and shackled. I walked around with my phone videotaping in 4K just so I can always go back and remember the look of the mama holding the baby in one arm and reaching out to the leader with another. That was the first thing I saw walking into that museum. As I continued towards the slabs hanging suspended from the ceiling, they had counties, they had states, and they have names. And on some of them, they have the word unknown. And in that moment, I could only think of the spiritual. Steal away. Recognizing that the thousands of names that were up hanging on those stone slabs, those unknown folk, that some of them would rather not be here anymore, that some of them knew that the atrocities were so great, the evil was so real, because we assume that the evil is gone, but the evil is still here. This I know to be true. Steal away. Trumpet sounds within my soul. I long to stay here. Green trees abandoned, poor sinner stands a trembling. Our faithfulness to these melodies, our strength, our courage, our resolve, even as we're tested, we still stand and head towards the white gleam of that star cast before us. Because I got to Tulsa, and I spent time interviewing one of the leaders at the Greenwood Cultural Center. And she told me all of that, the bombing, the destruction, was tied to capitalism. She told me that some of the white leaders came to the black leaders of the Black Wall Street area and said, we need you to move, because at the time, Tulsa was Magic City. It was an oil capital. The black leader said no. They then started doing smear campaigns in the newspaper, calling it a cesspool of iniquity. And when they got the opportunity to let that evil shine, they dropped bombs on us. But it didn't stop there. They even tried to change the fire ordinance to make it more difficult for the people in Tulsa to rebuild. But she also told me that by 1927, just 6 years later, most of Black Wall Street was back. But in that space, they shared a story about what happened on December 24th, 1921. Thousands of black folk stood in the street with the rubble, singing in the midst of tragedy, because they knew it's in these melodies, these magical melodies, these divine melodies, lies the answer. It's as time gets darker, we need to sing more together. We need to create the heavenly choir, make space for everybody at the table to come in and recognize that choir, that music is the beloved community. Where bitterness does not exist, but also where conflict is resolved. But this storm, y'all, we've been in the storm too long. We've been in this storm too long, and it's time for everybody to rise up and say enough.
I've been in the storm so long. I've been in the storm so long, children. I've been in the storm so long. Please give me little time to pray. Oh, tell my mother how I come along. Please give me little time to pray. With a hung down head and an aching heart, oh, give me little time to pray. I've been in the storm so long. I've been in the storm so long, children. I've been in the storm so long.
is dark out there. The world darkens, and without open eyes, we need somebody greater. We need the divine to enter our hearts. We need to make space by repenting. We need to lean into one another. And know that something bigger than us all got our backs. Know deep in our hearts that in that darkness, in our brokenness, we will find each other. We will embrace, as I said this morning, our shared humanity.
The world darkens without your open eyes. Stay with us and free us from fear. Jesus wakes and rebukes the wind with eyes full of light and clear sight. Christ says,
I sang over my mama's grave, over her casket in 2006. I know that Jesus has me in 2022.
Oh, when I comes to die,
let's welcome our incredible panelists up. We got the Reverend Dr. Alton Pollard. We got the Reverend Curtis DeYoung. We got Reverend Nekima Levy Armstrong. We have Joe Davis, and we have Amanzi Arnett. Let's give it up for them, everybody. shared. But in this space right now, as y'all are the teachers, what will it take for people to finally see? What can we do? How can we get the folks in this room to go out and say enough is enough? Anybody got any answers?
I think this work moves at the pace of relationship. I think that so much of what we found ourselves in, we're moving at this machine-like pace, and we're causing harm to ourselves and each other. I think we have to be intentional and proactive in slowing down long enough to listen to our bodies and listen to our spirits and listen to the bodies and the spirits around us so we can find healing. If we want collective liberation, we need the collective. I talk about how this work isn't about black people versus white people. It's about everybody versus racism and systems of oppression. So we all got a role to play. And yes, there's different amounts of trauma and there's different amounts of power and privilege. But my question is, how are we using that power and privilege to benefit those who are being harmed? And how are we healing from our trauma? I think that requires us to slow down and to deepen these relationships and to listen to each other. And that's a practice that I myself have to commit to and come back to again and again. I'm convinced that healing is communal and that wealth and abundance is meant to be shared. I think once we get in relationships, we start to learn that more and more. And that's what I want to create space for. So, yeah.
We can clap. You can clap too now. You ain't got to just snap. You can clap. Does anybody want to add anything?
Thanks, Joe. There were two things that stuck out to me as I listened to the stories. And as a white person, I was listening for the white folks in the stories. And there were two that jumped out at me. One, and the word is empathy. Yeah. The gentleman who you spoke to said, Ahmed Arbery didn't deserve to die. Even if he was stealing, and he wasn't. Yeah. But if he was, he didn't deserve to die. That kind of empathy, which is what the phrase Black Lives Matter is all about.
Amen.
Is that there should be a basic empathy as human beings. The second one was the historic figure, John Rankin, who you mentioned, and it was the phrase co-conspirator. So empathy is one thing, that helps us feel, but there needs to be an action that comes out of the feeling. And it's not being a white savior, which is a tendency. We want to step in and solve it. The word we've used a lot is allies more recently. It's a term I like, appreciate. But co-conspirator is a stronger term. Allies implies, like we're watching the Ukraine right now, we're asking for allies. Like allies show up in crisis and stand on the front lines. And that, but co-conspirator, to me, is like, we're in this for the long haul. I'm taking risks. This may cost me something long term. And so I really appreciate that term, co-conspirator.
Yeah. Thank you.
Nekima, you are in this space, in community, day after day after day. And I know you have to be tired. You have to be tired dealing with the same old, same old. I want to ask you in this space, as these people live in this area, can we give them something specific to do, something tangible today that would be of help to you and people like you who are doing this work and who are exhausted doing this work?
Sure. I would say that, well, number one, thank you for inviting us into this space with you and filling us up through the power of your voice, through storytelling and song. You are clearly anointed by God to do this, and I appreciate you going deeper in this work and being a living example, right? So as we were sitting there and opening ourselves up to your experiences, I think that things were being triggered in people's minds in terms of maybe a time where their actions might have reflected the woman in Sensilla Shores who said, basically, you're disrupting our way of life.
Yes.
The system typically works, so leave us alone.
Yeah.
And maybe others who are like the man who took you to the location of where Ahmaud Arbery was hunted down, right? And so I think that it's important for white people to, one, understand that history is now, right? We tend to think in terms of American history and in terms of biblical history as something that happened a long time ago, something that we read about, but we need to begin to see ourselves in those stories. That's what helped awaken me, because I went through the education system just like everyone else. I went through the college system just like a lot of you. I went through the graduate school system like many of you. And you are conditioned to think a certain way in this society. And most of the way that we're taught to think is to focus on ourselves, our families, making sure we can buy a home, we can buy a car, our children are set up for success. And anything that threatens that means that you push back against that in your own way. And it could be through silence and just saying, I'm just focusing on myself and my family. I'm living the American dream. It could be through silent anger when you find people showing up who disrupt your way of life or quality of life, or it could be even more proactive where you're picking up the phone, calling 911, or calling elected officials, or calling in to radio shows, expressing outrage at people who are disrupting the status quo. So I think that it's simple to sit back. It's simple to come to church on Sunday or sometimes throughout the week and say that you're a person of faith. I think the more difficult challenge is making a decision to live out your faith and to follow the examples that Jesus actually taught, where he went to the poor, he went to the marginalized, he went to those that were disdained by the rest of society, and he ingratiated himself amongst those individuals. So if people want to actually do this work, I mean, we're at ground zero right here in the Twin Cities. And this has been going on long before George Floyd was killed. As a matter of fact, we were shutting down freeways trying to get people's attention before May 25th of 2020.
Truth.
Right? And only you all know what you were doing before George Floyd was killed. Only you know what you were doing since he was killed. And only you know what you're doing now. Right? It's between you and God. So all I can say is that there's so many ways to get involved. Not everybody's going to be in the streets and shutting things down. But some of you have influence with people in positions of power. Some of you are in positions of power. So how are you leveraging that power to make a difference? So the most recent example, Amir Locke being shot and killed while sleeping in a Minneapolis condo downtown, and bringing to light some of the lies we were told about the banning of no-knock warrants in Minneapolis and the way that some police are able to shoot first and ask questions later and take a life, and then we're left to pick up the pieces. Well, one of my former law students, Athena Hollins, is a legislator.
Okay.
And she is carrying the no-knock warrant bill during this current legislative session. How many of you have been paying attention to that legislation? I want to see a show of hands. Okay, so just four or five. And thank you for those who have. That means the rest of us need to get involved. We need to see what that legislation is about. When there are hearings, show up on the call virtually, pick up the phone and make calls to elected officials and tell them that you want to see that no-knock warrant bill being passed. That is a simple thing that people can do, and it's just one of many, many examples of how to get involved. We talk about money that flows throughout the Twin Cities, throughout many of our churches, beautiful cathedrals. We're in an art gallery right now, right in the heart of downtown. But all we need to do is drive 5 minutes away to North Minneapolis and we look at the what's supposed to be the Black business corridor, and you see dilapidated buildings, homelessness, all kinds of things that are going on there, how many of us have bothered to say, what can we do to help transform North Minneapolis and particularly West Broadway into our own Black Wall Street, where we are building up Black businesses, creating jobs for Black people, building up economic justice and allowing people to be able to purchase homes in their own community, right, which has generational effects. So those are a couple of examples of things that I think people could do if they're serious about living out their faith.
Reverend Alton Pollard reminded me that today is the 2-year anniversary of when Breonna Taylor was killed. Today is the 2-year anniversary. What is happening in Louisville right now towards justice? And as a man of faith, how can we help folk in here demand that justice by walking and sharing our lived theology? What does that look like?
Louisville's a city without justice. We don't even have accountability. And I say that advisedly because it could easily be interpreted as our being as a society and a people in a place without hope. But I am always reminded of the words of the poet Herbert Woodward Martin, who, upon the assassination of Martin Luther King, said these words: "We have taken 2 steps backward. Nothing has changed. We have taken 2 steps forward. Everything has changed." And while I have been here this week with my new friends and colleagues and co-conspirators, I think of us even more deeply as siblings, because the safest place that another person can be is in someone's heart. That is the safest place of all. And do we have enough wherewithal to invite others into that sacred space within us? Some of you know that I am a native of St. Paul, Minnesota. I grew up here, and I hated it. And I said that I would never return. I was sharing this with Nekima and with everyone at the table here. And this week has reminded me, as I've been engaged in the struggle all over the country, having lived in so many places, as a pastor, as an academic, as a leader in higher education, in all kinds of other things, that you have to always find your way home. My parents came out of the Delta of Mississippi in the fall of 1955, short miles away from where Emmett Till was lynched. And through the years, I've shared, Tesfa, that so many of my family have never wanted to go back to Mississippi. And it took this week for me to realize that I have been in the same predicament, not ever wanting to come back to Minnesota because of my own traumatic experiences of growing up in blizzard-like conditions that had nothing to do with the weather. And I must come to terms with the depths of my own trauma, living in this lily white world, which in the 60s did not look anything like it does today. And because of the stories that I have heard this week and because of the people that I have met here, the measure of hope that those sorrow songs raised, those songs that I used to hear every day at Fisk University with the Fisk Jubilee Singers, have welled up again and given me the courage to believe that the good fight, the good trouble that I have been engaged in everywhere, I can come and participate in it here too. So I am so very thankful to you, Tesfa, and to all of my siblings here. And my prayer is that as we take up the struggle, that we will remember the words of Angela Davis. Struggle is a constant process. Freedom is not something once gained and then you can sit on your laurels. Or to put it in the words of Coretta Scott King, struggle is something that once having been done, you must do it over and over and over again with every generation. And this is something that we have not been teaching each other, let alone ourselves. And so I would simply encourage us all to not only find those places that John Lewis talked about as good trouble to get into, but once having gotten into it, understand that you may be in a place of trouble that may not be concluded in your lifetime. The fight is not given as a promise that is ended in our mortal line, but it transcends us because our humanity transcends us individually. I am because we are.
I'm pretty sure that there's some people in here who might have some questions for our panelists. This might be a good time to open the space for a few questions before we conclude.
First, I'd like to thank the panel members as individuals and collectively for raising our consciousness and awareness of what we have to do today and as we leave here tomorrow. I'm always struck with the idea that it's so easy to come to talk about my story or your story, but when we can come together to talk about our story, this has real meaning. And I appreciate your encouragement and your inspiration in this regard.
Thank you, all of you, for sharing. I'm very desirous of hearing what the second gentleman, has to say. That's my question. The panelist, I'm sorry, person.
Just what it is.
Wait, can you hear me? Okay. Well, thanks, Tesfa, and Kelly, and everyone responsible for us being here. And thanks to everyone. I've been absorbing. This has felt quite different today for some reason. And I think about healing the most today and what that means. And for us, Black people and other marginalized people, of course, we have to heal ourselves and find our way to our true selves, because this world never wants us to see that. It's always the gross, warped representation of what we are in white people's eyes. And we do, like we were talking about earlier, being hypervigilant and how we shouldn't have to be that way. And even the rage that we have to feel, which is not low vibrational or anything, like it's important, but we want to have joy. We want to be loving. We want to be welcoming. And that's what we naturally are when you think about African peoples, when you think about indigenous peoples, and you know all the proverbial invitations to the cookout that we give out, things like that. And we have to think about wanting to be in those spaces, because I do think that's the spirit of who we're meant to be, but also think about what barriers there are to that and what lack of safety there is in that often, because we have to think about what we're met with. And so I would advise white people, even in a spiritual sense, to think about throughout history what you've done when you've been shown hospitality, whether that's been indigenous people when white people have settled here, whether that's been to black people, African peoples on the continent, whether it's been us when we share our stories like this, what will you do with it when you leave? And even in a biblical sense, you know, the great story of sin, y'all like to pin on us, queer people in Sodom and Gomorrah, the story truly was about that hospitality that wasn't there, about visitors that were threatened and about to be conquered, and think about who you are in that story and what destruction you're bringing on yourselves, maybe not in this realm, but spiritually. As the spiritual says, everybody talking about heaven ain't going there. And I think that that's your work, to think about like who you are in the story. Are you Lazarus or are you the rich man? If you think about what Christ taught, and if you were to ask us, what can I do? And one of us is like, sign over everything you own to a organization of our choice and follow us. Would you do that? And that's always the tricky point with dealing with white people. And Dr. King said it, Martin Luther King, you know, all of the things that didn't cost money, they were able to do, integrate the lunch counters, get voting rights passed. But as soon as you start talking about reparations in the form of money, that's where people get upset. And beyond, it's not truly about the money, it's about your relationship to loss and risk and what you're willing to give up, your safety, your comfort. And I this room is interesting because I think about how white people love painting Jesus in their image instead of living in his image. And so that's the charge I would give. It's like, he's right here. If you want to be anti-capitalist, if you want to feed the poor, if you want to transform your life, it's already there. If you really listen to Christ, if you really listen to Martin Luther King Jr., if you really listen to Fred Hampton and Fannie Lou Hamer and Nekima and all these people who are speaking out, instead of hearing what you want to hear from them, and it's never changing. And so healing is up to us in different ways. The work isn't all the same. And like I said, our healing is to want to be peaceful and want to join hands. But part of that is y'all making it so that it's safe to do that and doing your part and not skipping to the part where we're just singing black and white together. Do the work and heal. And that's it.
Thanks. This is a Memphis-centric question for Amanzi. I'm curious, I'm hearing threads of hope centered here in the Twin Cities with the folks that are like digging in and doing a lot of work. And I'm curious what you're experiencing, if there's anything giving you hope in Memphis. Got a lot from there, so there's a lot going on. Just curious where you're seeing hope and possibility for healing in Memphis.
Where am I seeing hope in Memphis? Honestly, a long time ago, I learned to redirect where I look for hope, because we often look for hope in the politicians and people outside of you to change. And honestly, my people bring me the most hope. Coming back home and being in the community where I grew up in and seeing people, you know, there's this idea that, you know, if black people could stick together, we stick together. And it's just seeing the work people do and the sense of community, the joy, the laughter, the music, the art, all of that, that no matter what we've been through, we can transmute all of that and still laugh and still have joy and all the things that you would think that we would never have after all of this time. And that gives me hope. It does give me hope at times to see the face of someone else change, or maybe a white person making some effort, or, you know, a cis heterosexual person making some effort, things like that. But that can never be the source of my hope, because that's fragile. But to answer your question, my people give me hope. And not just the resilience, because I hate centering that, but the joy and the love and the care, the direct care and the mutual aid that happens on like the smallest levels, even in the form of a head nod in a room where you're the only two, that keeps me going.
Thank you. And thank you to the panelists and to Tesfa. I'm so glad that the conversation has like taken this turn like towards the joy too, because that's something that I like to center in my conversations around liberation, around racial reckoning and all of those things that we so have to focus on. My question to you all is, what does liberation look like? What does it feel like? Right? Yeah, so just get us in that mind frame of, child, I just want to be doing this and doing. And I feel like it paints like a clear picture too of just like, just how stifled like our joy is when we even just speak the simple things of mangoes and sunshine is what live relation looks like, being at peace, and things that we've heard like Nina Simone like speak to when she talks about, you know, freedom and what that looks like for her and how simple it is, but also it like brings about the complexity of that at the same time existing. So, yeah.
For me personally, I started finding my most joy when I began repenting. I felt liberated when I recognized that if we're gonna make it through this, we gotta get our house together. And I started laughing more. I started singing more. I started praying more. And man, I'm having the best time of my life right now. And that trip to repair, I thought it was about to repair based on the communities. What I found was the internal repair that was needed. And in that moment of recognizing that throughout the trip, day after day after day, even when I found some of the most gruesome and callous stories you could imagine, as Amanda said, the hope was found, the joy was found, when I realized I was a part of it as a comfortable black man. I hadn't been doing enough. Nekima said, you know what you were doing before George Floyd. You know what you're doing after George Floyd. And so I find me personally, to truly be liberated requires repentance.
Yo, joy for me is just when I'm dancing wild and free. I ain't worried about what nobody's thinking, when nobody's doing, like when people know me as an artist, they don't know me as a dancer. A lot of people know me as like a poet or as a band leader. But like when I'm by myself, I really feel free and I really want to experience joy in my body. I just move, and I just dance. Like I don't have to worry about people policing my body, telling me how to move my body, what to say, what to do. I can just move it however I want. Whatever I feel in my body, I can let that out, I can release that. That's what joy is to me. And that's what I want to create the space for everybody to experience. I think that Black liberation is collective liberation. And when we create spaces like that as an artist, like when I do open mics and theater productions, and like my hope and my attention in that is that people can experience that freedom and that sense of joy to say and do what is liberating for you. Like, how do you identify that and then practice that? Because I think the more we proliferate that into the world, then we have a freer world, a wholer world, a fuller world. That's human flourishing right there. And that's what I want to create more space for. So like, you know, I talked about us moving at a machine-like pace, and I got to work just like everybody else to survive capitalism. So I'm on my Zoom meetings and doing my emails and all of that. But what I'm intentional about is I have to create space for myself to experience that joy. So I got my playlist, you know what I'm saying, in between the Zoom meetings. I could play my favorite song and get my little 5-minute dance break in between, you know, or whatever. Whatever ways I have to find it, I have to keep coming back to that rhythm again and again so I can show up as a healthier and more whole person. Because if I don't have that space, I could tell the difference. You know what I'm saying? I show up and I'm feeling kind of like raggedy and kind of like sluggish and my energy's low. But when I'm able to cultivate joy in my life, I'm able to share that joy with other people, right? And people can feel that from me as well. And so I appreciate that question. I hope that we can all find that space for ourselves, find it together.
Chaplain Kelly from Hamline University for all that she did to make it.